Today, here we are this glorious Tuesday, July 4th. I wish to congratulate all of the people south of the border on their ability to be able to be still free of what other people would call third world suffering. I know that the 4th of July is quite a celebration in the United States, and this video is dedicated towards breaking free of the vestiges that surround that celebration. I'm certainly in no way offering any disrespect. All I'm trying to say is that the corporation known as the United States of America was pretty much put together after 1871 and the Federal Reserve Act, and of course House Joint Resolution 109. So many of us have been long on the trail of coming out of Babylon, and many of us have tried many of the theories accepted for value, UCC codes, I am not that man. There are just endless amounts of theories coming from men and women that know truly in their heart there's something wrong. They don't want to participate in it, but somehow they got scammed and they didn't find the simple aspect of escaping a religious fraud. So tonight I'm going to try and deliberate a little bit about the simple aspect of not using the deliberations of men, not using the statute codes and regulations of men. You can mention them all over the place, but you can't make use of them. People are thinking, well, how do you mention them without making use of them? And it's by warning them. If you turn to Ezekiel chapter 33, verses 1 through 10, you see the admonition upon the watchman that if he fails to warn the adversary, somebody who's come to harm you, and those who may be harmed, the blood of either that may die is upon his head, the guilt. So it's a duty to warn as a minister, and if some of you have not read John 15 and 16, I strongly direct you to the offer that Christ made us all. And we're all different, of course. Some big, some small, some wide, some skinny, some arrogant, some shy and meek. All of us have the common denominator of accepting the offer because, of course, at our own willingness to change our mind's way of thinking, we can adapt to the path, narrow as though it may be, that Christ has offered us in being his minister, ordained by him, not some men or women, but surely taking note of the fact that anybody popping up saying I'm ordained, it's completely within relevance and even common sense to make a bit of a test to ensure whoever is saying that they are ordained, know the precepts of Christ, and indeed the precepts of men under his authority. So I'll start off with the methods with which we as a group, the Autochthon Society, group of men and women, indigenous and otherwise, to the continent, Turtle Island, North America, when you wish to put faith on your sleeve, it must be worn with the very attractive colors. Warm colors, make ye friends of the unrighteous mammon. All of the old remedies in the past were very sterile, mechanical theories of men not utilizing scripture. And the modern ones of people that have used scripture to offset de facto false god authorities have been adversarial in format and certainly not offering the fig leaf. So, or pardon me, that would be the olive leaf. So the idea is that if we turn to Matthew 5, verse 25, he says, get in agreement with an adversary quickly while thine are in the way with him, lest at any time he turn you over to the magistrate. I'm just getting a call here. I'm going to shut that off and I'll pick it up later. If I can get it to shut off. There we go. So when you gain an agreement privately with men and women, as advised in Matthew 18, 15 through 20, which is the formula for Matthew 5, 25 in the King James, when you go to your brothers and sisters privately, between thee and them, it says, and you try and see if you can work it out, is being as nice as you can, remembering love your brothers as you do yourself, as the rule for trying to deal with them. So all patience must be observed. You will likely be tested. You will likely be, they want to bring you to the point of anger. And so it takes great resilience to resist when somebody's insulting you, maybe even pushing you, to not resort to the same type of energy that they are exhibiting. And this has been a major failure for men and women over the millennia that have been trying to escape the beast. You can't do it by aggression. It must be done peaceably, in love, in honor, and with truth and agreement. So when we read Matthew 18, 15 through 20, there's three steps there. And those three steps are incorporating only God's law, only God's rule, only common sense, only the love of Christ to gain your adversary's agreement as to the facts. And those facts may be, now I'm starting off with, you're not a person. You cannot be a person of law because Deuteronomy 1:17 says God's no respecter of persons, as does Deuteronomy 10:17, as does 2 Samuel 14 and 14, as does Matthew 22:16, as does Acts 10:34, where Peter says, surely I perceive God is no respecter of persons, as does Romans 2:11. So when we take it beyond Romans 2:11, we really get a description there of James 2:9, where we're admonished with the fact that if we respect persons, we're guilty of the law as transgressors. We've committed sin. So the admonishment of the scripture to not associate with respect or have dealings with persons is similar to how you're not supposed to associate with the dead. In the Bible, that word person started off back in the Old Testament, as we saw in Deuteronomy 1:17. And when you take it back to the Hebrew to say, well, what did it say there in Hebrew? It said goyim. Now, goyim is a Yiddish word used as a derogatory slur against non-Jewish men and women, Gentiles of the world. So if we are to examine the weak spot of the system, we must fully understand and believe that it is being run by men and women with a religious history and following. And it is a religious bait and switch show set up with putting the Bible up to get your trust, a bunch of men and women swearing to be truly allegiant to another woman who swore to defend the laws of God with all of her power. Now, I'm sure that not any of you have ever seen the parliament of any of the countries wherein that you've lived in or live in, the United States or Canada, start promoting God's law, except for maybe Reagan when he passed the Year of the Bible. Or I think somebody else passed the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. But the fact that I'm getting at is law works like it's first in time, first in line. Now the first set of laws that we have put down are right there in the Bible, the commandments, the one true God. And as it turns out, when we distill them down as Christ did, love is the factor there. When you're in love with your brothers and sisters, there's no harm, there's no crime. Everybody's happy, things rolling along just fine. It's when there's a dispute, well, rather than to get into the fisticuffs, our direction from Christ at Matthew 5:25 is to gain an agreement. What did I do wrong? Maybe I can fix this. Is it true that XYZ? Is it also true that XYZ? Do you also agree that XYZ? And by doing this diligently and repetitively, avoiding making use, like you certainly don't want to be a citizen, that is a Roman term, and it's relative to being submitted to false gods. You want to be a bondservant of Christ, Corinthians 7, 22 through 23. You want to check out and read that to find out how you are Christ's free man. His blood washed away all those laws that were contrary to us and against us. You can easily see in Colossians 2, verses 14, and it says, he washed away, the blood washed away the laws that were contrary to us and against us. So obviously we got two different sets of laws here. God says, don't add to my law, don't take away from my law. Deuteronomy 4:2, Deuteronomy 12:32. So we know right away God's not the author of confusion. He's never changing. So if he said don't add to his law and don't take away from his law, that's final. That's it. It's over. We ain't going to be changing from that point, at least if we're going to follow the scripture. So when you go look at parliaments and legislatures set up under a Christian monarch and all putting their hands up, taking an oath to be truly allegiant to her as defender of the faith, you say, well, where did they get the authority to make statute, code, and regulation and enforce them upon people? Well, they don't have any authority. It's a consensual contract. Your parents entered you into that contract when they registered you as informants. And so they have you down listed there as a surety because they needed some flesh to back up the monetary system, as in 1933. They seized all of the gold. It's taken right out of the vaults. The creditor, the world bankers, come along and said, you owe us that money. And so on April 10th in Canada, they suspended the Dominion Notes Act, which authorized using gold as money. And if you put your money down, they'd pay you gold back. So when they started using flesh for security, and for the proof of that, the Canada Interpretations Act provides a list of all the words that are used in the enactments of Canada, and it's the definitive authority for what those words mean. So I looked up person in that enact, and it says includes a corporation. Corp oration. Corp is dead, oration is speaking. So it's dead speaking. Can't have anything to do with it's dead, it's unclean, also classified as a person, which we are not to respect, lest we commit sin. So knowing that the Bible supports you in these scriptures that I point out is essential, because with me, it just flows. I've been brought up with the scriptures, I've always known them, and as I became more involved in studying the laws of men, it drew me much closer to the Bible, and I became to have a review of what I'd thought before and reestablished some former falsehoods with some present truth, which was very gratifying to me because I was very much confused growing up with the Bible as to some of the questions I had asked remained unanswered. I couldn't understand why we're bowing down to these guys, Caesar, and paying them taxes. It was totally contrary to the way the Old Testament was laid out. We are not supposed to bow to false gods. We are not supposed to walk in the ordinance of the heathen, Leviticus 18, 3 and 4. And I'm hoping some of you will take the time, stop the video, go back, write down the scripture, and diligently look through these scriptures, because I don't propose to be an expert on anything. So I would hope that nobody will just take me at my word. I'm some guy full of hot air, that you'll diligently research what I'm saying to see if there's a flaw. I'm proposing to you that there is no flaw in the scripture, but there may be a flaw in me. And as you go along in life, whenever you're learning something you want to pass on to somebody, encourage them to strongly and diligently cross-reference what you've said to ensure every word is presented the way it's supposed to be. Make sure of all things, in other words. So once you've done your good job of showing why you can't be part, like if you went to the U.S. Secretary of State or the President and said, I need to resign from the corporation known as the United States. I know my parent registered me at birth. I had no knowledge that I was being used as a surety to give value to a security so it could be traded on the stock exchange, and I'm listed as a beneficiary. Because of my faith and beliefs and discovery that I am not a person, but I am a man, and I cannot show respect to persons nor have association with the dead, I am asking you for accommodation. I'm requesting that you aid me in escaping the intimidation, discrimination, and abuse that is typically taken place when a man wishes to confront government agents with the fact that he cannot submit to their codes, rules, and regulations. Immediately, that man is seen as a troublemaker and a terrorist. And in Alberta here, which seems to have traveled the globe now, has been deemed OPCA. That's organized pseudo-commercial argument. Well, one doesn't want to be labeled or have a label when you're trying to walk in the footprint of Christ. You wish to cleanse yourself, just like 2 Colossians verse 14 tends to say there. You wish to get to the point where at the end, verses 21 through 23 in 14th chapter of Colossians, says, why would you, as being freed from the world with the blood of Christ, go back and subject yourself to ordinances? It's a question. And so basically it's what's been saying. He gave his life, let his living waters flow, so you can wash away all the statutes and codes of men, because they're not applicable to you, only God's law. And yet some of us, even after learning that, will go back and partake of the vomit. That's the scriptural philosophy of going back to the false god. Like when it says, rend under Caesar that which is Caesar's, we go, well, Caesar is one of the creations of God, another man. Well, what did Caesar own? If God owns all the gold and all the silver and the whole breadth of the world, what does Caesar own? He doesn't own anything. And certainly, Caesar had no ability to command people to obey him and his laws and pay him tax, especially if they were ministers, as you can see easily by reading Ezra chapter 7, verses 23 through 26, where the designation of who occupied the temple is written, and the jobs and duties of the minister is written, and one of them was pay no tax. So now we got a contradiction taking place between what the Old Testament is saying and what Paul is writing in the New Testament. It's almost making us think like we're supposed to bow to Caesar. But he's not saying that if you read it closely. He uses the word minister in Romans 13 three times. That's three for emphasis in the Bible. It's pretty powerful. And we look at that word minister and say, well, it can't mean anything other than what is described in Ezra. They're supposed to judge with God's law and teach them that know it not, and they're not supposed to pay taxes. So you can imagine this is quite disconcerting when it's presented to a prosecutor. Now, I have done this and helped other people do this, and charges were dismissed and thrown out, and they leave them alone after you start walking the path and you start glowing like a man endued with the Spirit of Christ. So there is process. Now, this thing about identity, it's important when you're using documents. Of course, you want to have some type of name on there to communicate, Star Child, something that they can communicate to you with. Now, the Bible seems to indicate that when we take up the faith, that we're reborn and we're supposed to take on a new name. That can be problematic. There have been people that have been put in jail for doing this. Hard to believe, but nonetheless, that has taken place in the past. So if one wishes to take on a new name, I would suggest that it would be done with the coordination and group affiliation coordinated. In other words, a group of men and women bear witness to the purpose and reasoning behind the newborn in Christ's adoption of that new name. Now there's corroboration and witnesses confirming it. Now you're safe. But if you try to do it by yourself, the old adage is stomp on them quick before he multiplies. I had this happen to me because here in Canada, being that I started back in about 1995, I was pretty much by myself, and right away in the country where I lived, in the rural areas, I was classified as a lunatic, a crazy guy, and oh, that old fake Bible thumper, etc. Because of the old school, Romans 13, got to pay your taxes, nobody bothering to take the time to read the scripture, to cross-reference, just accepting what came from the pulpiteer. So the identity issue, that word identity, I'll talk briefly on it, is relative to identification. If I bite on a piece of leather, the marks that I leave behind are identification. You can look that word up, it's in the dictionary, identification. Of course, denta is relative to teeth, dental. So you got to ask, well, why is the letter I changing it? All of a sudden it has nothing to do with teeth anymore. Well, it doesn't. They're telling you that the newer version of that word means to prove who you are. Well, yeah, because you're listed as a valuable commodity. You've been assessed with a value, collecting annuities annually, and you were listed as owned property. Back in the days when they weren't so subtle about slavery, the owner, in order to identify, sometimes they had over 1,000 slaves on their cotton plantations, the owner, in order to know which slave was which, bit his slave. So his teeth and dental impression, his dentification, would leave that special mark on the slave so that they knew it was his. If it had been stolen or run away, he could locate and claim that slave again, just like a thumbprint. So I'm a little shy of using the word identification because I believe, just like the word person in reference to myself, I don't use it anymore. There are many words that have been used as a trap to ensnare us. 2 Peter 2 and 3 will relate that to you, that with feigned words and merchant covetousness, and they will make, feigned words and covetousness, they shall make merchandise of you. Now, I use the scripture selectively to expose and embellish our ability to see the fraud, and we can see the escape door as well. Over the millennia of the fraud existing, submit to the government, pay your taxes, Romans 13 pulpitism, many people's minds have forgot how to think. That's not an insult. That's an observation of history. We've been trained to rely on the guy up in the pulpit, the pulpiteer, to interpret the Bible rather than picking the Bible up and reading it itself with some critical thinking, trying to figure out what this means. Then we got some questions, we're not sure. Then you go to the priest and you're going to go ask him, see if that concurs with what the book says. So that didn't take place too much in an illiterate world where only 2 or 3% of the population was literate in the old kingdom. In this kingdom, we have so many different methods of gaining an agreement that A, you're not a person, B, that you can't be compelled to violate any laws contradicted to or added to God's law. And I could go on and on and on. I'm not going to give the words for the various points of the agreement in this video. That wasn't my point. My point was to, rather than using any commercial text where it can be seen you're reliant upon it to gain a benefit from it, and that's why you're using it as a usufruct, the all statute, code, and regulation is copyright and intellectual property owned by the state. It is property of the state, and since the state is a commercial debtor, in debt, the creditor owns all the assets and all the property of the debtor. And that would include you if you're registered within that state. So by doing this private notice and agreement, and by letting them know that you have adopted a proof of existence, certainly I exist, a fly exists, a crack, a grasshopper exists, a bear, a cat, a dog, they all exist. Sometimes you want to see proof of existence, good, there's a pile, a steaming pile on the floor. There's some proof of existence. And you can even see the vapor. So to prove that we exist, people everywhere, whether they be at airports, on the side of the road, they want to see some proof of who you are. Well, as it turns out, you cannot be compelled to associate yourself with a dead thing. You cannot be compelled to respect persons. As long as that King James Bible sits beside the judge on the bench in all of North America, as it does, then you are free from the assumption that you have to submit to these false gods. They are. They set up shop. The first thing they do is they got a question. What's your name for the record? The Bible says, be the head, not the tail. If you give in and answer that question, you've just submitted yourself to the jurisdiction by appearance. Appearance in law means the formal process by which one submits themselves to the jurisdiction of the court. So you don't want to do that. So the way you present yourself without making a submission is by only asking questions. Are you aware I stand here in the kingdom of God as Christ's minister, dealing with matters relative to the ecclesia? Can you confirm to me that you are standing in God's kingdom so I may speak to you as a man? Are you aware I cannot show respect to persons as it violates my faith and the directives of the King James Bible? Would it be your intent here today to intimidate me, to violate my faith, and what statutory resolve will you be relying upon to defend yourself should I take action in tort against you? These are the kind of questions, and I'm just spewing this, you know, off the cuff. There's no memory. I've never said that before. It's entrained in me, and it will be in you too. Once you start to believe that those scriptures are your freedom, the truth will set you free. You don't even have to think. The Spirit will put the words in your mouth. Don't think about what you're going to say in court. Pray. The Spirit will put the words in your mouth. He's done it for me. He's done it for others. I've watched it happen. It's like tears flowing down my face. A miracle takes place. When you see the power of redemption take place, it's like the energy in people's eyes. They brighten up as if you just turned on the light bulb. I've seen it take place. It can happen in the ones that you least expect, and it likely isn't going to happen in the ones that you most expect. That's what the scripture says for us. So, since nobody knows who is going to be chosen and who's not, who it's going to work for, etc., it's relative to pumping up your heart to the word so it's in the same frequency as the mind and not divided. The heart will work with the mind if you focus on the scripture to balance the two and tie them together. And so that was my little diatribe today about ensuring that the documents, the words that we use on paper are not making use of man's law. This is scriptural. This is not a theory of mine. This is the directions of Christ, the directions of Yahuwah, of the Old King, the Old Testament. And aside from all pulpitism, which I detest, we must be diligent as ensuring that we follow the scripture to a T, because when you use it, as in Ephesians 6, 10 through 20, putting on the whole armor of God, you don't want to have any chinks in that armor. That's why it's knowing it well or having somebody to guide you. I certainly offer my services to anybody that asks. So when you are tested, you can also always rely upon somebody. Remembering, though, that Christ warned those that would come between him and the little children by telling them if they would do so and attempt to inhibit them from taking on the knowledge of Christ, that they'd be better off putting a millstone around their neck and throwing themselves into the ocean. So when you're a novice and you're a beginner, some people here listening are like that. They're not very familiar with the scripture. You have more protection than ever than somebody who's been at it for 50 years. Because Christ's energy wants you to learn. It wants your mind and heart to expand with that love. And the only way it's going to happen is if you get special protection. Because the stumbling is always easiest when you're leaning up against the post and you haven't ridden that bike for the first time. As you're pushing away, invariably, nobody does it the first time. They always fall and skin their knees. Just like in the Matrix, nobody makes the jump the first time. Everybody falls. So it's okay to fall. Remember, Christ is there to pick you up. Your faith in him, your resilient love, it can take you to places that you've never conceived. And the people that will come to join up with you will come out of the woodwork. They'll be knocking on your door. The bells will be ringing. They'll be asking questions. There'll be a barbecue in the backyard. So I'm glad that you've all taken the time to listen to me, and I hope that this invokes a few questions and maybe some directions to me. That would be great. And I'm hoping this has helped settle and rectify maybe some of the questions and problems that many people have had over their lives of struggling with the fraud system and wishing to come out of it. God bless, and have yourself a great day. Bye for now.